Hello, welcome to Innovation Studios. My name is Michael, and today I've got something very exciting that I'd like to show you guys today, and that is I actually created an animation using traditional hand-painted animation cells. So if you guys would like to skip to the part of this video that has the animation, I'll probably put a time somewhere around the screen. Because what I'm going to be doing for the first part of this video is that I'm going to be talking about what animation cells are, how are they used, briefly talk about their history, and why did I decide to use them. So, what are animation cells? Animation cells are nothing more than transparent sheets of plastic like this, that on one side, let me just put this away for a second, on one side, you would actually trace the lines using a dip pen with India ink. And then, once you got the India ink to dry, then you would flip the cell onto its other side and you would paint it with acrylic paint, like this. So, and of course that's not going to be the only example that I'm going to show you guys, because I made some pretty cool artwork that I would like to show you guys to demonstrate further exactly what a finished animation cell looks like. Alright, so I'm back with the artwork, and this is actually the animation scene that I was talking about earlier. I actually recreated a scene from the movie Howl's Moving Castle, and this is the result. So let me show you guys basically in very brief details how does, you know, like these animation cells thing work. But first, I'm going to show off this Sophie animation cell that I made right here. And as you can see, yep, basically it's clear plastic with artwork on it. And this actually would be the side that you would draw your lines on. And then if I flip it to the other side, you can actually see that it looks pretty strange. The reason is because this is actually the side that you would paint your acrylic paint on. And what you can do is you don't need to be so precise with your painting skills with here. Well, I mean, at least when you paint it to the edges. But if you're painting on top of another paint layer, you don't have to be so precise, because it could just overlap. And then when you flip it onto the front side, it still looks pretty good. So that's basically what an animation cell consists of. Here's my animation cell that I made of Hal. And same thing as the Sophie cell, one side has the, you know, like the lines drawn on it. The other side has the acrylic paint painted onto it. And then the next thing I'm going to show you guys is that this is typically what most animation backgrounds are like. They're usually like some kind of art paper. And basically you paint it with either watercolor or gouache. And I actually use gouache in this case because I like gouache a whole ton. I'm not the best painter in the world, but that's not the point of this video. Anyways, so what you would normally do is that you would basically take your, you would usually have your background gouache painting on this peg bar right here first. These peg bars are meant so that the, when you switch these cells, you know, because usually there are like 24 different animation cells per second of animation, when you keep switching them and then you go back to re-photograph them, it doesn't like jitter all over the place. It can actually stay very still. And it's very nice, and I'll prove that to you. But before I do that, once you got the gouache painting in here like this, then you would put the animation cell on top of that. And then of course, if you got another animation cell, then you put the other animation cell on top of that. And then you actually get the completed frame of animation. And just to prove that, the registration and all that stuff is pretty good, look at that. I just shake this thing and this thing just doesn't come off, so that's pretty awesome. I really hope you guys like this artwork. Once you got a completed scene like this, what you would then do next is that you would actually assemble this underneath a 35mm film camera on a camera stand with two light bulbs at the side. And I actually did the same thing for my animation project. I shot it with film, by the way, a very special type of film, Fujifilm Provia 100F. You would shoot this film, you know, like with the frames like this. And the key difference that when you're actually shooting the thing versus what I did here is that you would actually have to clean your animation cells every time you are about to put the animation cell on, because these things tend to get very dusty, and you obviously don't want that to show up in your film, because film is expensive. So basically once you got the animations, once you got your frame set up like this, then you would actually take a picture. And then once you're done with that, you would get rid of the old animation cells, and then you would put in the next advancing animation cells. And then you would take a picture. You take a picture of these next advancing animation cells 24 times, then you would actually get a second of animation. And what you would then do is that once you're done shooting, you know, like your film, then you gotta get it developed. And in this case, I actually developed my film at home because I really love film developing. But anyways, yeah, so you would get your film developed, and then in the really old days, you would actually get your film optically printed onto a 35mm film print so that you could use it on a projector. But however, in this case, nobody really does 35mm film projection anymore, and plus my format is weird. It's shot in VistaVision. Yeah, so and there's basically no VistaVision projectors anywhere. But anyways, yeah, so what I then decided to do is that is to send the film over to get scanned, and I actually got this scanned at North Coast Photo Services. So yeah, and basically once you you send your film to get scanned, they scan it and they send it back to you, and then you know you just basically put all these frames into some magical software, and there you go, you got yourself an animation. This is the way that actually animation used to be done in the 20th century, and there's actually a really great video out there that really talks about the history of how, you know, animation cells were used in the 20th century. What I basically talked about was the basics. This video really covers in depth and more detail than what I can do here. So yeah, so I really recommend that you guys go check that video out. I put the link to it somewhere in the description of this video. But what I am going to say though is that so yes, this was basically the only way for most of the 20th century to make an animation, a hand-drawn 2D animation. But then in the 1990s came along a technology called digital ink and paint. And what that is, I'm sure most of you guys know what that is, but basically everything that I did here, you just do it on a computer. All the inking and all the lining, you just do it there, and you don't have to worry about dust, you don't have to worry about scratching animation cells, you don't have to worry about the spaces that animation cell takes, and so on and so forth. And plus, you don't have to wait for the animation cells to dry, because obviously when you put acrylic paint on them, they take a while to dry. You don't have to worry about any of that. But the thing is that not everyone adapted to basically using digital ink and paint very quickly, because the thing is that as with any new technology, digital ink and painting was very expensive at the time. And, you know, and basically animation sets were cheaper for the most part. So what happened is that basically mostly from the 90s to the early 2000s, there were actually still a lot of shows that still used animation cells. Stuff like Cowboy Bebop, Neon Genesis Evangelion, you know, even the first season of SpongeBob used animation cells. And actually, one of the biggest supporters of animation cells during the 1990s was Hayao Miyazaki's Studio Ghibli. They actually used in Princess Mononoke, you know, and all the films before it were all animation cells. And Princess Mononoke was pretty late 90s. It was actually 1997 when that film was released. But unfortunately, yeah, digital ink and paint did eventually get cheaper, and a lot of studios actually ended up converting because of the reasons I said. You know, you don't have to wait for animation paint to dry, which really cuts down the time that it takes to finish an animation project before a deadline. Which is unfortunately what Studio Ghibli tends to do a lot. So this frame right here from House Moving Castle was not using animation cells. This actually was a digital ink and painted movie. Yeah, so this animation cell right here of House Moving Castle is probably the only one that exists in the world because, you know, like, yeah, because the movie was actually done on digital ink and paint. But even then, there was actually still quite a bit of holdouts against digital ink and painting. The most notable one that I can think of was actually The Simpsons. The Simpsons actually did use animation cells for basically until the mid-2000s or something like that. I can't remember quite when did they stop. But yeah, way after when everybody converted, you know, they were still using animation cells, which is pretty awesome. And one more thing I have to say is that did you know animation cells were actually still being used 4 years ago? That's right. There was actually a show in Japan called Sazae-san, which is actually listed in the Guinness World Book of Records as being the longest show out there. And that's actually the reason why they still tried to use animation cells, because they wanted to keep their animation cell heritage. But eventually, in 2014, they did end up converting to digital ink and paint. And ever since then, though, in a way, animation cells were never truly dead. There were actually still a lot of people that still tries to bring animation cells back. And there are actually some YouTube videos that I actually put links to so that you guys can watch them. The most notable one to me, though, was a video made by Brandon Corey, and he actually did a recreation of a scene from Snow White, and he used traditional hand-painted animation cells to create it, and it was very cool. And that was actually the video that inspired me to try to use animation cells. And actually, this is, and ever since then, it brought us to right here today. I wanted to use animation cells because I'm sure it doesn't really come off across in the video. These things are very nice to look at in real life. The lines, you know, are very crisp. The colors are amazing. I bet you the camera cannot even capture that. The colors of this are amazing. And plus, I really always had an extreme love for film ever since I was younger. So of course, and also, even though animation cells do take time to make, they're a lot of fun to make, and I really, really encourage you guys to make animation cells of your own. And that's what I plan to do in the sometime in the future, to show you guys how to make these animation cells. So with that being said, yeah, so I've actually created more animation cells other than the one from this house moving castles scene. I've actually also done this one of the, I don't know how well you guys can see that, that's probably the best angle, of the DuckTales scene from the intro of the cartoon. I've also done that, and I've done many, many, many more. They're so much fun to make. And basically, you know, once I made so many of these animation cells, then the thought occurred to me, why not make an animation out of them? So yeah, that's exactly what I did, and I'm very excited to show you guys what that is. So, the animation that I've been making over this entire summer is called The Animated Spangled Banner. It is an animation of the American flag, and it's very simple. It's basically, it has 50 animation cells, and it just repeats over and over again. The reason why it's so simple is because I've been animating ever since I was 12 years old. And now I'm 20, and I've never finished a single animation project, ever. So I decided that, and here's a very good lesson for you guys, and the reason why I never finished an animation project until now is because I've always done projects that are just simply way too big for me to handle, and then I just give up. And then I would do another project that was way too big for me, and then I give it up again. When I decided to head back into animation, you know, using animation cells, I then decided that I wanted to start small so that I know my limitations, you know, and what can I do, and try to get me into this hobby so that I can make better and grander animations from there on out. Yeah, so the message that I wanted to tell you guys today is that basically start small and grow big. That's my life lesson to you guys. Anyways, as I mentioned before, the animation that I've been making is called The Animated Spangled Banner. It is of the American flag waving, and it contains 50 different animation cells, legit animation cells that I painted and inked and all that kind of stuff. It uses 12 different animation paints, colors on it. And what I'm going to be doing is that, of course, there's a reason why it's called The Animated Spangled Banner. I'm going to be running this 2-second animation for basically around like a minute or two, and I'm going to be playing the American National Anthem. Now, the main reason why I wanted to do this animation is because, you know, of course, as I said before, I wanted to do a very simple project, but not too simple one. Because, and this is where the second point comes in, this American flag is the most accurate you will ever see in an animated film before. I've always had a pet peeve when I saw, you know, like animation films where they always draw the American flag wrong. I always hated that. In my version of the animation of the American flag, it actually has all 50 stars and it has all 13 stripes. Yes, and if any of you guys know anything about animation, coordinating the movement of 50 objects at one is certainly no easy task. And of course, through the course of basically 50 frames. Yeah, that's pretty tough. But I did it, and I am very proud to show you guys. So, one more thing that I have to say before I show you guys what the animation is that please stick around for the end of the video as I got something very cool that I would like to show you guys at the end of this video. So anyways, I know this sounds so cliched, but ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy the animated Spangled Banner. Hey guys, welcome back. I hope you all enjoyed my animation and thank you so much for sticking around because I got two things that I would like to share with you all. So the first thing that I'm going to talk about is this. This is a 35mm slide, and if you ever heard of the term slideshow before, this is the thing that actually came up with that term. Because so inside in the middle of this thing right here is basically 35mm film put onto a slide mount. What you would do is that you would put this thing into a projector and then it would show off whatever images that you got on the film onto a huge display. Major applications of this would be like business presentations, school presentations, but the cool thing that most people actually did with these is that they used this for family photos, for like vacations and so on and so forth. And of course, in my case, I actually use slide film, that's what the film is called, in a very special way. I actually used it to record my this animation with. The unique thing about slides is that you don't necessarily, it's not like a negative where like you just get these ugly brown images of film and all that stuff. If you hold this thing, you don't need a projector to see what's on this thing. That's the awesome part about it. If you hold this thing to the light, you will actually see the images already on it because it's a positive transparency. So it is so cool. And as I mentioned already, I shot my movie on slide film. And I have my own reasons why I decided to do that, but I think it'll make this discussion a little bit too long. But I'm gonna go straight to the point. It has amazing picture quality. And because I was shooting with slides, I then thought, why not actually, you know, like make a lot of slides so that, you know, you guys can, so that I can sell these things to you guys and all that kind of stuff. So, so I really hope you guys like that idea. And basically, if you want to, you know, like purchase these things, I put like the link to the eBay listing of this thing in the description below of this video. But before you do that, I would like to say some things first about how I'm going to sell these. So you guys are probably wondering, like, why on earth would you ever want to get one of these? Well, there are basically two reasons. The number one reason is that this right here is the world's sharpest display. Yes, and I'm not making this up, because basically I did the calculations, and since Fujifilm Provia is a very high quality film, I actually calculated this little image right here, which I got a little bit of a comparison. This is an SD card. It's only a little bit bigger than the size of an SD card, but yet it contains a little bit more than 8K of information inside this little thing right here. Yes, believe it or not, this image right here is 8K. So obviously, I mean, like, we got like 1080p, 4K monitors and so on and so forth out there. Well, I haven't really seen an 8K monitor that much. There are probably some out there, but there is no 8K display that is this small. So obviously, yeah, it is a very sharp and crisp image. It is amazing. And on top of that, of course, if you don't care about the sharpness of the image, the colors of this are very amazing. And I didn't believe this until I actually saw it with my own eyes, but these things have a very three-dimensional effect to it. The reason is because, unlike digital, where the sensor is basically a flat surface, films, you know, like, has basically three color layers, and they're split like this. So yeah, of course, when you see these things in real life, it has like a semi three-dimensional look to it, which is pretty cool. The second reason why would you guys like to buy one of these things is because if you guys would like to support this animation channel, this is the number one way to do it, because I don't take donations. I don't do Patreon, I don't do Kickstarter, I don't take any of that stuff, because, you know, I want to, every single money that I earn, I want to earn it. I want to work for it. I don't want it just to be given to me. So yeah, so basically, if you guys really want to support this animation channel, this is the best way to do it. So I'm going to be selling two different varieties of basically these slides right here. Now, the one I got in my hand is what I call a master slide. The way that these are made is basically, so of course, you know, when I take the animation cell, I obviously have to photograph it onto film. Well, the film that just came straight out of the camera is this. The master slides are the film that saw the original animation cells. So of course, they're going to be the best quality. The other type of slides that I'm going to be selling is called animation slides. I actually don't have any of those available right now, but they'll be available sometime in the future, and I'll explain why that is in a little bit. But basically, they are prints of the master slides. The reason why I don't have any animation slides with me right now is because I need to buy a particular type of machine that is able to make prints with them. As of right now, I currently don't have the funds for it, but sometime in the future I'll be able to afford it, and then of course that's when I start making the animation slides. But yeah, so the animation slides are, as I said before, are prints of these. So the problem with prints is that they're obviously not going to be as good quality as this. But the advantage with animation slides is that they will be available forever. The thing with master slides is that, yes, they have very good quality, but unfortunately, they're going to be limited quantities of these. And the reason is because I can only keep the animation cell out for so long before it gets dusty and all that kind of stuff. And I only have so many film to basically use up that night that I shoot those animation cells. So what I've done is I basically, for this particular scene of the animated Spangled Banner, I shot 624 of these master slides. And I thought it'd be, you know, reasonable to basically divide it. I keep one half of it and sell the other half to you guys. So as of right now, there are only 312 of these master slides available right now. So yeah, these are basically limited quantities, but they offer the best image quality. And actually, this is the version that I'm currently selling on eBay right now. So yeah, I'm currently selling this for $6.95 with free shipping. And it basically comes with, of course, the slide right here. And then it comes with this polyester protective sleeve to protect it from dust and all that kind of stuff. It slides on like this. And then it also comes with, I actually came up with this, with basically this vinyl record styled jacket that you can basically slide your master slide into. And this is basically what the package looks like. It's going to be all shrink wrapped and all that kind of stuff. And once again, it's $6.95 with free shipping and all that kind of stuff. I hope that price is not too exactly steep for you guys. I basically try to make it the lowest amount of the lowest price possible, but while making profit, because unfortunately, you know, like eBay fees and all that kind of stuff, so really eats up your profits. So basically, $6.95 is really the lowest price that I can do for this stuff. Yeah, so hope you guys really like this idea, and I'm really looking forward to seeing you guys really enjoy these master slides. Oh yeah, and before that I say that, so the animation slides are going to come in sometime in the future, and I'm not sure about exactly what I'm going to price those, because, you know, it really depends on how good quality the prints are, but I'm thinking about, if the prints are in really good quality, I'm going to probably charge $5.95 for them. Whew! Now that we got that out of the way, the last thing I would like to share with you all is that, you know, now that I'm actually selling master slides and all that kind of stuff, you guys are probably thinking in the back of your minds, well, if you're going to sell the master slides, aren't you going to sell the animation cells as well? Well, yes, but in the future, and I got a very good reason, because I'm actually not done with the animated Spangle Banner. So this version that you saw was basically the daytime version, but the next version I'm going to do is a nighttime version. And it's going to be very cool, because it's going to contain fireworks in it. And yeah, and I've actually been working on what I should call the animated Spangle Banner 2. So you're probably wondering, what are all these big stacks of paper in the behind me are? And they're actually, this is actually the rough draft of the animated Spangle Banner 2, which is actually complete. And this is the final artwork of the animated Spangle Banner 2, which I'm actually not finished yet due to, you know, with me being busy with all of, you know, like schoolwork and all of this Master Slide stuff and all that. Yeah, so, but once I do it, I am willing to bet you that this pile right here is going to be triple, like up to here and all that kind of stuff, which is really, really huge. So this is going to be a very big endeavor for me. And to give you an idea of how much bigger this is, this stack of paper right here is basically, or stack of folders, as I should say, this stack of folders right here is actually the final and rough drafts for basically the animation you just saw, the original animated Spangle Banner. And yeah, look how small it is compared to basically just only the rough draft of the animated Spangle Banner 2. Yeah, so this is going to be a very big project, and I cannot wait to finish it off and show it to you guys. So I really hope you guys are looking forward to the animated Spangle Banner, and yes, that's basically all I have to say. Now, this is usually the part of the video where most people just say, please like and subscribe and blah blah blah, all that kind of stuff. You don't have to do that. But there is one thing that I would like to for you guys to do, and that is to share this animated Spangle Banner news with all you guys, that animation sales are back, you know, like with family, members, friends, you know, on social media and all that kind of stuff, because it would do a lot to support this animation channel. And heck, you might even find that you might actually have a family relative that used to work in animation and actually used to make animation cells. So please share this news with all you guys, and I really hope you guys enjoyed this video, and that's basically all I have to say. So I really hope you guys enjoyed this animation. My name is Michael, this is Minovation Studios, and I'll keep on innovating animation frame by frame. I'll see you guys later.